In this video, I'm gonna be building a boardwalk, a pathway through the woods and up to my brand new outdoor kitchen. There are plenty of ways to do this, but I went into this project trying to use the simplest method I could think of, and if I can be biased for a second, I think it turned out great. Let me show you the steps on making your own. First off, take a look at my land beforehand. It is far from level and plenty rocky. One way I could have approached this is to bring in material, either dirt or rock, to make this area flat. However, that is a lot of work and money, so instead, I'm gonna let my pathway ebb and flow with the natural ground here and only shore up on the low spots. This is unconventional, but stay with me, folks. My plan is to build boxes from 2x4s, and these boxes will be the framing of the boardwalk. With that, I started by cutting up all my material. I personally try to never move material more than needed, so I set up my cutting station so that I could pull a board from the back of the truck, cut it up, then make a pile of my cuts. Be sure to check out my discount codes if you're interested in getting isotunes, which are my favorite Bluetooth hearing protection, or a stealth mask, which is my go-to respirator that's not only comfortable, but also does a great job at expelling your hot breath. Once all my boards were cut, I started assembling. I moved to the flat deck to work, and I used galvanized ring-shaped nails here. I'm gonna be using Trex composite boards to match the deck, and they need to be supported every 16 inches. So that's what determined my framing layout for these. As you can see, it's very simple construction and building 14 boxes went quickly. Next, I left those sitting aside, then started working on the stairs. I've done several videos now on building stairs, so I'll link to those if you need that information. But for these, I actually went with pre-made stringers found at the big box store. I had to pull up the fascia on this one section, but not a big deal. That way I can use some joist hangers to attach these stringers directly to the deck's rim joist. I didn't bother with pouring concrete. Instead, I laid out some gravel to create a level pad for a 4-inch paver. And you can see that each paver is wide enough to support 2 stringers. I made sure they were spaced apart equally, then nailed on a riser at the very front to lock them in position. Those are the simplest stairs I've ever built. All right, now to start shaping the pathway. At first, I carried all my boxes out and laid them roughly in place. At this time, I'm pretty much just laying them head to toe and get them roughed in. I'll come back afterwards to get the shape refined. This will allow me to make sure I got the length correct and let me know if I need to make more or take away some. Keep in mind that I determine the size of my boxes to get the best use out of material, but you can make them shorter or longer. Oh, and I don't think I said it before, but this is treated material. With it being in direct contact with the ground, you definitely want treated. With all of the boxes laid out, now I went through and started making the shapes. The start of the path is pretty straightforward. It needs to line up to the stairs, but the back is where I wanted some flare. I wanted a slight, well, maybe medium is correct. I wanted a medium curve to give it some character and to also avoid some heavy duty rocks I didn't want to mess with. Oh yes, I think that will look really nice. All right, now let's start joining the boxes together. I started up at my stairs and secured the first box's header to the header of the stairs using a few screws. Then I went to the back of the box and did the same with the following. The important thing here is to get the top surfaces of the boxes flush with one another. Left and right doesn't matter as I'll have an overhang on the deck boards and you'll never be able to tell, but flush on top does. Once the boxes were secured together, next I worked on leveling it up. I would lay some gravel to create a level pad to set a paver, then read level and keep adding material until it was good to go. For this project, I picked up both 4-inch and 1-inch pavers. Then anytime I needed something in between, I would actually use Trex cutoffs. It's composite material that won't rot, so it's perfect for shimming up the low side. To save on material, I would break my giant pavers into smaller chunks.
Yeah.
To do that, you just need to find a good breaking rock. Something else I did was push the boxes out of square. I think this is the first time I've ever built a box and intentionally made it unsquare. But by skewing the square, it helped create a smaller curve that led up to the bigger curves. To keep the skew, a scrap can be diagonally placed across it. Now, me personally, I was only interested in getting the pathway leveled left to right this way, not forward and backwards. This means that each section has a slight difference, but honestly, now that it's in, it isn't noticeable. One thing I did to help this was break up any rocks that were massively in the way. Another option is to certainly build up the supports and go over them, but I was loving how even the entire thing was turning out and didn't mind removing the few rocks that would make me build up higher.
Can you pop that for me?
When I eventually got around to my larger curve, I started only attaching the squares together at one end, then leaving a wedge shape at the other. Now to give the structure support, but still keep my curve, I used my Triton saw to cut a long tapered cut. In fact, one cut will yield two boards. This can easily be slipped into place and secured with screws. Again, making sure the top was flush. I placed the wedge on the next four or five boxes and it created a beautiful sweeping curve just like what I wanted. And there we go. All in all, this stage went really quick. Total, it took about 5 hours to attach all 14 boxes and level them. I don't know if you can tell the huge difference, but in person, it was really starting to look neat at this point. So next, let's start laying down the deck boards to really bring it together. I started off up at the stairs and just started working my way down. As I do that, let me give you all the details. First, I'm going with Trex Composite Decking, which is the same decking I chose for the outdoor kitchen as well as the floating deck. It is more expensive upfront cost, but the huge advantage to it is that it will not rot. It never sun fades. It will never need to be finished or refinished. So it's the most one and done sort of product you will ever get your hands on. I love this because it means I can put in all of this hard work to make it right, then never have to touch it again. Even though Trex is composite, it still expands and contracts and needs a space between the boards. I chose a 1/4 inch space and used some small spacers to make setting things in place quick and easy. Now, you cannot brad nail in these boards only. I'm using a brad nailer to temporarily secure my boards because the screws I ordered had a few days delay on arriving and I wasn't patient enough to wait. So I'm securing each board with a galvanized brad nail right now, but you'll see I come back later to actually screw them down. By doing it this way, I was able to really fly. I would haul over a stack of cut boards and spread them out behind me so that I could secure one, reach behind me for the next, and repeat. The important thing I was paying attention to was the spacing in between each board, but the overhang I was just gauging by eye. I was aiming for a 4-inch overhang on each side. However, I ordered 20-foot boards, and to get the most out of the material, I pre-cut them all to 4 feet exactly. With that, at this point, I had about 6 inches of overhang on each side, so there was room to play with there. If you're gonna be cutting in curves and you want this overhang, and I'll explain more on that later. When I got to the decking portion of the big curve, I also started playing with the spacing where it wasn't even. I know that this will drive a lot of you nuts, but this unconventional project is just pushing a lot of standard rules out the window, so just go with it. To make this curve, you can certainly cut each and every board to a taper so that it maintains the 1/4 inch gap exactly. However, I didn't mess with that. I left a bigger gap on the outside than I did on the inside, and it worked great. I went through and first placed all the spacers to make sure I was liking the way it would turn out, then I came back and nailed the boards down at once. Once I got the fat side secured, I placed smaller spacers on the inside and nailed them down. Once I was past the curve, I went back to 1/4 inch gaps on either end to straighten it out. Whew! Personally, I think this is so awesome. I find it unbelievable that this much progress was able to be made in just, I don't know, 1.5 days? Okay, by this time my screws had arrived, so next I went through and started securing the boards down nice and proper. These screws look similar, but are slightly different than the ones I've been using. The heads on them counterbore a hole as you drive in the screw. This hole created as you drive in the screw fits a plug to cover up the head so that it looks seamless afterwards. This allowed me to face screw in the boards, which is a really quick method, but keeps the final results looking nice and sharp since you can't see any of the screws. Simpson Strong-Tide makes these plugs in all the colors that the composite decking comes in. If you have a decking project coming up, I'll leave you a link to Simpson's page to look your colored plugs up. Okay, and now the last step. Well, outside of landscaping, cutting in the outside curves. When I was laying down the deck boards, I left the left and right of the board running wild. So it does look like I installed it blind at this point, but that is about to change. The Trex boards are pretty flexible. So to make a long sweeping curve, I actually grabbed a few and used them as a reference to trace. I would clamp the ends together to make a long enough run, then secure them temporarily to the deck. I just needed them in place long enough for me to trace the flow. One thing to pay attention as you're creating the shape is the overhang. I was aiming for 4 inches, but with this being curved, it won't be consistent, which is fine by me, but I did run through and check before cutting that I didn't have any spots where the framing boxes would show. If I did, I just moved the shape over slightly until that low spot had an overhang. A jigsaw or a circular saw can be used to make the cut, but a circular saw will give you a much more consistent cut if the curves you put in will allow it. And voila. Okay, so I have broken more rules in this one project than any others I've ever tackled. By not working on leveled ground, by not pouring concrete footings, throwing out even spacing, intentionally making things out of square, and yet look at this result. It's beautiful, it's strong and secure feeling, and it's exactly what I wanted, but took me a fraction of the time and cost. The only reason I bring that up is because knowing traditional methods is really beneficial, but that's not to say that it's always the only way of doing something. So as you're planning and building, be resourceful, and if it makes sense to throw something out of square, then I say try it. Now, I fully anticipate once or twice a year I'll have to come through and shim up the low spots, but that doesn't bother me. Leave me a comment down below and let me know what you think about my little rebel pathway. And of course, if you have questions on anything I used in the video, I have left you links down in the description. I'll see you on whatever I'm building next. Real quick, I want to thank a sponsor of this video, which is CuriosityStream. Some people look for video streaming services for mindless entertainment, while others are interested in platforms that will teach and inspire them. CuriosityStream is a streaming service that has thousands of documentaries and nonfiction TV shows on topics like history, nature, science, food, tech, travel, and more, all to teach and inspire you. It has all of the content that you need to satisfy your hunger for knowledge and spark new adventures. CuriosityStream has award-winning exclusives and originals that you can stream to any device for viewing anytime, anywhere. Subjects like innovation and construction, backpacking, ancient mountains, great ocean mysteries, current events, and more. My watch list is already so long. CuriosityStream is well worth the price tag with its impressive library of highly rated documentaries. You can get all of the best documentaries on the planet for just $2.99 a month, or you can use my code Wilkerson to sign up and pay only $14.99 for a whole year. There is really something for everybody, so head to the link in my description box below, sit back, and enjoy the best documentaries on the planet. There really is something for everybody on there, so head to the link in my description, then just sit back and enjoy all the documentaries you can. If you're interested in building a garden, don't forget that I have a set of plans showing you how to build a raised garden with an enclosed fence around it. The plans show you how to build one box so that you can build one or 10 like I did. You can click here for plans and here to subscribe to the channel.